It's the 3rd of July, 2002. It's really bad weather. It's raining. You can hardly see anything. A car is driving on the highway, close to Lausanne in Switzerland. And all of a sudden, this car starts to slide and becomes uncontrollable. In a split second, this car crashes into the guardrail. Luckily, no other cars were damaged, but this one, total loss. An ambulance brings the driver to the nearest hospital in Montreux. Luckily, the driver is alive, but is in shock and has severe bone fractures. That driver is me. The next day, I wake up on the intensive care, and I can hardly imagine what happened the night before. I mean, I just moved to Switzerland for my job, which was a fantastic adventure, but also a scary step. Back in the Netherlands, I had a great life with my friends and family surrounding me. And I left it all behind to start a new life in a strange country. When I was lying in that hospital bed, something snapped. I mean, I was really happy that I survived the car crash, but I had to change something. This really was a signal, this car crash. I mean, I was living in Switzerland, and I was disconnected from my friends and family. I had to do something. And I realized that when I was lying there, I never realized the true importance of true connections. And I never realized I wasn't immortal until that night on the 3rd of July, 2002. I never took life for granted ever since. To feel those connections again and to get connected with my friends and family back home, I decided to move back to Netherlands as soon as I got the possibility. But by the time I got back, social media became popular. And soon most of my friends had a smartphone. No, they didn't have a smartphone yet, but they had a phone like this. Maybe you recognize it. And so that had an impact on the way we communicated. And I remembered by then using this phone. I only use it for emergencies because it was quite expensive using it. Maybe you remember that. It always also tells me my age a little bit, but I hear people laughing, so you recognize this. I'm happy for that. And but nowadays, I cannot imagine having a smartphone, having not a smartphone. A life without a smartphone is, I think for me, but also for the most of us, is something that is unthinkable. To be honest, I'm pretty sure that at least one person here is checking his smartphone right now. Yeah, there is a person. I mean that's okay. Eh? When we look at social media like WhatsApp and Instagram and Facebook, it brings us a lot. I think by then, if I would still live in Switzerland, it would help me a lot to still be in close contact with my friends and family back home. Right now. I noticed that we often use it as a replacement of the spoken word and the face-to-face contact, instead of using it as an extra possibility to connect. When I look at myself, I have a busy life. My friends have busy lives with children growing up. And we find it difficult sometimes to catch up. When I come home from work, they're feeding the kids. When they have time, I have dinner, and so on. And we text each other in WhatsApp groups. You probably recognize that. But we have to be careful because the friendship can wither away like that. I figured out that connecting takes time, but we get more and more impatient because everything else in our life goes faster. And there's something else with the social media. I don't know how about you, but I don't like to wash my dirty laundry in public. But we all know that we have dirty laundry, right? Yeah. Well, when I check social media accounts, to me it looks like everyone has a fantastic life. And I mean, I'm not complaining. My life isn't bad at all, but I don't always look like this. I have bad hair days, and I make mistakes. I mean, I'm happy that I make mistakes, because I learn things if I make mistakes. But it looks on social media, we hardly post about it. And that changes something, because with this constant stream, with this constant flow of perfect lives, of fantastic lives, we get afraid. We get afraid to make mistakes. And that influences the way we think about each other and the way we communicate with each other. I mean, you don't even have to leave your house anymore. You can sit in your pajama all day, order your groceries online, chat with your friends. I think you can even follow a course online and book your holidays. You just don't have to leave your house anymore. And this is not the only thing that is changing. Demographics are changing too. Smaller households are increasing. There's a shift to smaller households. Not only in big cities. When you look in the Netherlands, statistics predict that of every 10 people, 4 will already live alone by the year 2016. And in big cities, this is already the case. And also, when you look at the way we work, the amount of freelancers is increasing. In 2017, already out of every 9 persons, every one person out of every 9 is a freelancer. And you probably say, well, freelancer, well, that's maybe good, bad, I don't know. Some people are out of free will a freelancer, and some are freelancer more or less forced, but they don't belong to a team. They miss that sense of belonging. It will not surprise you that these changes demographically and digitally make the number of people that feel lonely increase. And when you feel lonely, you feel disconnected. You feel unsafe. You miss that sense of belonging. You miss being part of a group. And it can even affect your sleep and your immune system. And eventually, you can get sick. I believe that loneliness is our new public enemy. And if I look at myself, it scares me because I'm an enthusiastic user of social media and I'm a positive person, so I post positive things. I do not always post my mistakes. You might recognize it, but that's how I use my social streams. I text my friends instead of calling them. I don't do that all the time, but I see that I sometimes text because I have many other things to do, and yeah, I should have picked up the phone, but I text them. My household is a small household. It's just the two of us. We don't have kids. So we don't go to schools or to soccer fields where we meet other parents and chat afterwards. And I'm a freelancer. That means that if I already belong to a team, it's on a temporary basis. I realize I tick all the boxes of someone who can become lonely. I am right in the danger zone. To me, it's clear that true connections are now even more important than ever. And that requires good communication skills. And I'm happy, I mean, we're all together here, so you have talked with each other, you have communicated, maybe you connected already here and there. So we already have those skills, this is the good news. But sometimes we just forget how to use the skills actively. So do I. And I was thinking, when do I use those skills? And it popped in my head that I use these skills actively when I travel and when I photograph. Then I make true connections. Let me take you to the Gambia. We're in 2013, not mistaken. And I'm on the beach and I meet Halimatu. You see her here. Halimatu is a lady and she sells fruit in these bright blue fruit stalls on the beach. And I buy fruit from her every day. She and her co-workers are there every day selling delicious fruit, and I just love to go there. And one day I'm there, and while she's preparing the fruit, she's cutting the fruit, I give her a compliment about her hair. I mean, she has these amazing dreadlocks, and with my hairstyle, you can imagine I envy hair like that. So I give her a compliment, and she's a bit shy, and her co-workers start laughing. And one of her co-workers, she gives that attitude, and she says, "It's fake, you know." Okay, I don't have much hair, but my hair is real. Fake? I didn't know what to say. So they start laughing because they see my expression. And one after another, they take off their scarves. They take off their wigs. And they're laughing. And I'm like, what's this? I'm just buying fruit here, you know? And then they explained to me that they buy the hair on the Serracunda market a little bit further down the beach. And they, every day they glue it on their head. They're not sleeping with, they're sleeping with bald heads. So I didn't know what to hear. And, you know, at that moment, at that beach, I didn't feel a distance. It was just girls talking about girls things for the guys right now. Yeah. We're just talking about fun things. And I was surprised by their openness and about their honesty. And I really felt part of their group for a moment. And I realized at that moment, by giving them my sincere time and interest, I made quicker true connections. We moved to we moved from the Gambia to Mongolia. It's 2017, it's June, where I meet Angie. Angie is a little girl, 5 years old. And after a long drive through the desert, we arrive at the house of her family. I mean, they call it a house, we would call it a tent. But hey, they live there and they have a great life. Angie, she just turned 5, and she got a little bike for her birthday. And it's a bike with these small training wheels on the side. Well, you can imagine in a desert with training wheels on the side, it's not really comfortable. Well, she has her bigger brother, and her bigger brother knows that, and he's making fun of her because she's not going fast enough. And she's a little bit upset, I can see that. That's like a global expression on somebody's face. Now, I don't speak Mongolian, but what I do know is a long time ago, I was 5 years old too, and I do recognize that look on her face. So I take my chances. I walk towards her, put my hand on her back, and I start running. And immediately, she understands my plan. So she starts cycling on her bike, and she's looking at me like, yeah, we're having a good time, you know? And we're going really fast through the sandy desert, and her brother is like, what's this? What's this? He's angry. Hey, man, this is girl power, you know? And it was so funny, because I learned that taking the time to put myself in her shoes, I connected. And we didn't even use words to connect. Only recently, I was in Fez, in Morocco, where I meet Hassan. I'm in the Medina, and it's early in the morning, but it's already sticky hot. You know, this feeling, how hot it can be in Morocco. It's already dripping on your back and stuff. And I'm walking in the Medina, and salesmen are opening the shops. And all of a sudden, there's Hassan, with his arms wide open. He's walking towards me with a big smile. And of course, I know that he probably wants to sell me something, but he has this sparkle in his eyes, and that works contagious to me, and I get curious. So I shake his hand, and we start to talk about his life in Fez, about my life in the Netherlands, about the weather, of course, about all kinds of things. And after a while and a few liters of minty, I decided to say goodbye. And I realized that I had plenty of time to talk to Hassan. And because I looked beyond my first impression, we had a genuine conversation from one person to another. How do you feel when you get connected? What happens when you connect? After meeting all these people, I can tell you that I felt appreciated. I felt seen and heard. And I got this warm feeling inside. And I also figured out that there's a formula to connect. My time to give, my sincere interest, and my curiosity. And every time when I apply this formula, it results in having true connections with the people around me. As a freelance marketeer, I work for many companies. And to me, a company is like a country. Different language, different rituals, different dress codes. And to me, this is interesting because it excites me every time when I can start in a new company on a new assignment, because I can do exactly the same as when I'm traveling. I only wear different clothes, and those flip-flops I leave at home. Don't worry about that. I take over their language. I take over their rituals. And I apply the formula to connect. I give my time and I show my sincere interest and people feel this and they get connected. We build trust. And to me, trust is the basis for a good working relationship, or actually maybe any relationship. What was the last time you connected from one person to another person? I believe that true connections is why we are here. I believe that we get happier and live longer when we connect, because we want to be seen and we want to be heard. And it's not obesity. It's not smoking. But it's loneliness that increases our chances of dying the most. We can do something about it to open up. We can do something about it. And therefore, I would like to dare you to have the courage to connect. Therefore, I would like to invite you to do an experiment. I would like you to apply the formula to connect. Take your time and give your attention to someone. Show your true interest by putting yourself in someone else's shoes. And be curious. Ask questions about their life, about their work, about the family, topics, their opinion on topics that matter to them, and listen. Only if you just start doing that for one day. Because I believe one day I ticked all the boxes of someone who could become lonely. Right now, I tick to connect. And I believe that when we start to tick together, we stick together. Thank you.